Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Straight away, Jesus constrained his disciples to get into a ship. Jesus went on to them, walking on the sea. The disciples saw him. They cried out for fear. Peter answered him and said, "Lord, if it be thou, bid me come unto thee on the water." Jesus said, "Come."
I am yours, and you are.
you, Jesus, for showing me the way.
Not even here at all this year. Not even here. He looks so young.
I was watching last night. Kimber says, "Are you confused, man?" He said, "Good." Ouch. Yes. Exactly. Ouch. Yes. This morning, I want to talk about leadership. Many of you know, those that don't know, at the beginning of this year, I left a job that I was at for 8 years for a new adventure, we'll call it. In this new adventure, compared to my last, I went from being a manager of one to a manager of 7 to 8. And my, I wouldn't say concern, but my interest going into it was, I've gotten really used to leading my one coordinator. What does it look like to lead 8? What does it look like to lead well? And so the brain knowledge person in me said, we're going to find some books on it. And thankfully, the 40-minute-ish drive to Mount Juliet, we lost time to listen to Audible on the way there, and John MacArthur and Simon Sinek and some really, really wonderful books on leadership that I've been blessed to experience this month. And so this morning, in the prep up to it, I said, what is on the menu for this Sunday morning? Where are we going? And of course, the thing that I've been immersed in this month has been leadership. I said, no, not that I've ever preached on leadership. That's like a good idea. So let's go to the Bible and find some additional stuff on these books about leadership. And as God often does, he goes, you're not going to find what you thought you were going to find. Amen? Yeah. And so what I thought I was going to find was just like in these leadership books, you know, here's how to do it. Here's some tips. Here's the 10 steps to leadership that's found in the Bible. And if they're in there, they're a lot harder to find than I intended to find them. Instead, what I found was something very different, but something that, in retrospect, makes much more sense. And I told Tracy that the title for this sermon is Lead and Be Led. And me and Jessica laughed because lead and led are spelled the same, so it looks like lead and be lead.
Let me
led. Let me led, exactly. You beat my joke, Jim. Come on, Jimmy V over here. but really, what the Bible says is be led, be led, be led, be led, and then lead from that. So I got backwards. It should be led and lead. If you'll join me this morning in Joshua, as we get there, I want you to think of the leaders in the Bible that come to mind. Who are the great leaders of the Bible?
Moses.
Yes.
Abraham.
David. Jesus. Yes. We were starting at the beginning, Tracy. We're getting there. Paul, done. there are some wonderful examples of leaders in the Bible. Many would argue, I think there's actually a book on this, of the 12 disciples and how each of them were fantastic leaders, but in very different ways. I love books like that. Things that I would expect that reader to go, I don't know about that. I read them and go, okay, good job. There are some amazing examples of leaders in the Bible. Now take that same question. Who are the amazing leaders that you know in your life? I'm not saying that because I'm standing on the shade at the stage and want you guys to all say me. Don't worry. You don't have to say anybody. Most people say my dad, a manager that I had at a job that was really good, or maybe a manager that I had, that's my example of what a not good leader looks like. We've all been there. You know, coaches and teachers and pastors that we've all had. And so the question is, what is leadership? These good leaders in the Bible, these good leaders within our life, what actually is leadership? And the interesting thing that I found in some of these leadership books that I've read is the explanation of leadership is very simple. The execution of leadership is very not. Because all leadership really is how you influence people. How much you influence them, if you influence them at all, how many people you influence. The difference, just as I found, between the ability to influence my one coordinator and the ability to influence a shop full of people is pretty different. It was really easy to build one really good relationship with my coordinator, and I could ask her to do things that maybe she didn't want to do, but she knew that I wouldn't ask her to if we didn't have a good reason to. Versus 8 guys that in a month I've built some relationships, but it's going to take far longer to build 8 good relationships than the one that I had. But that's all it is. It's a measure of influence. There's a book that I think Jessica has laying around somewhere, something along the lines of How to Make Friends and Influence People, which I really don't care for as a title because it sounds sort of like you're trying to trick people, how to influence people, how to pull one over, right? But we are influenced, and we influence every single minute of every day of our lives. You're being influenced this morning by the words that I'm speaking. You're being influenced this morning by the songs that we've heard, by the classes that we've had. I'm influencing you with what I'm talking about. We are always being and influencing others. Influence is almost a currency that's constantly flowing. And so these good leaders in the Bible in our life that we think of as people who have influenced us for positives or negatives. Sometimes greatly, like maybe a teacher that we had or a parent, that our lives would be drastically different than that person in our life. Maybe, as I spoke to a boss that showed us, man, I just can't deal with this. This is not what good leadership looks like. But it's just a measure of influence flowing around us. And so in Joshua here this morning, I love this picture, and this is the very first beginning of Joshua. And in the very beginning of Joshua, it is coming off of the death of Moses. There's Joshua being given command, being given leadership of the Israelites. And in Joshua 1, it says, after the death of Moses, a servant of the Lord, the Lord said to Joshua, son of Nun, Moses' name, Moses, my servant, is dead. Now then you and all these people get ready to cross the Jordan into the land I am about to give you, to the Israelites. I will give you every place where you set your foot, as I promised Moses. Your territory will extend from the desert to Lebanon, from the great river to the Euphrates, all the Hittite country, to the great sea on the west. No one will be able to stand up against you all the days of your life. As I was with Moses, so I will be with you. I will never leave you nor forsake you. Be strong and courageous, because you will lead these people to inherit the land I swore to their forefathers to give them. Be strong and very courageous. Be careful to obey all the law my servant Moses gave to you. Do not turn away from it to the right or to the left, that you may not be successful wherever you go. Do not let the book of the law depart from your mouth. Meditate on it day and night, so that you will be careful to do everything written in it. Then you'll be prosperous and successful. Have I not commanded you, be strong and courageous? Do not be terrified. Do not be discouraged, for the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go. So Joshua ordered the officers of the people, go to the camp and tell the people, get your supplies ready. 3 days from now you will take across the Jordan here to go in and take possession of the land the Lord your God has given you of your own. But to the Reubenites, the Gadites, and the half-tribe of Manasseh, Joshua said, remember the command that Moses, the servant of the Lord, gave you. The Lord your God is giving you rest and has granted you this land. Your wives, your children, and your livestock may stay in this land that Moses gave you east of the Jordan. But all your fighting men, fully armed, must cross over ahead of your brothers. You are to help your brothers until the Lord gives them rest, as he has done for you, and until they too have taken possession of the land that the Lord your God has given them. And after that, you may go back and occupy your own land, which Moses, the servant of the Lord, gave you east of the Jordan to ward the sunrise. Then they answered Joshua, whatever you have commanded us, we will do. And wherever you send us, we will go. Just as we fully obeyed Moses, so we will obey you. Only may the Lord your God be with you as he was with Moses. Whoever rebels against your word and does not obey your words, whatever you may command them, will be put to death. Only be strong and courageous. And so Joshua, if you can imagine this weight, the entire people of God standing on the bank of this Jordan, and God saying, you're up, Joshua. But the response of the people to say, Joshua, we will go wherever you tell. We will follow your lead, and we will be with you just as we were with Moses. We pray that God is with you as he was with Moses. And so it starts very different. It doesn't start with Joshua saying, all right, I'm in control now. This is my ship. I'm going to steer it. It starts with God saying to Joshua, Joshua, I'm going to lead you just like I did Moses. And Joshua being this vessel for leadership that God has given to him. He's being led first as he leads those around him. He's being led by the Father. He is absorbing the laws, as God puts it. He's absorbing all that God has given him, every tool, every speech, every moment with the Lord. He's taking it all in and being led. And then putting on his coat and going, all right, with that in hand, let's go lead these Israelites. Let's go do what we have to do. Let's go where we're being called to go. He doesn't say, I'll get to that later. I know that's over there. I'm the leader. I'm going to go do the leader things. I'll circle back around to this stuff. He says, no, let me have all of this first. Because without all of that, I don't even know what I'm talking about. I don't know how to speak to the people. I don't know where to go. I don't know what to do. And Joshua, over and over and over through the book, the Lord says, Joshua, do this. And Joshua says, you got it. The Lord says, Joshua, you're going to fight, and the sun's not going to set. You got it. The Lord says, be led, and then lead. Joshua says, you got it. And I wouldn't have considered Joshua as a favorite of leaders previously. But in reading this, I just can't help but go, man, Joshua really got that right. Joshua just sat and absorbed everything from the Lord before he did anything. Because he needed to be influenced first by all that God had for him before his influence to others meant anything at all. He could have gone out, made his own choices, as we see with later kings that decide they're going to do things their way. The temple needs a redesign. We're going to retrofit this. These laws, I prefer this. I'm going to do things my way. I'm the king. I get to call the shots. We see bad things happen. Right? The people turn away from God. People say, all right, well, if the king is doing his own thing, why can't I do my own thing? Because leadership travels downhill. Joshua wasn't just speaking to the Israelites. He was speaking to his generals and his commanders and his lieutenants and the leaders in the city, all that are going to lead those under him. Joshua's not the only leader in the equation. Joshua's leadership to the other leaders, their leadership to the leaders beneath them. There's a wonderful story this morning that we talked about in Sunday school of my parents were church-going people and their parents were church-going people, and so that I know that where I stand today may have a lot to do with my ancestors and their faithfulness to God. The leadership that Joshua receives pours into his leaders, pours into their leaders, pours into their leaders, falls down to every single man. And so the whole country is led. The whole group is led from the top to the bottom because Joshua was led by the Lord first. Everything that Joshua is giving to his leaders is through and from the Lord. Everything those leaders are giving to their leaders is from Joshua, which is from the Lord. And it just travels downhill. Right? And so if I am to lead any of those, we have to take the same approach. Right? That same influence. That remember, we are all giving out. I love the idea that it's not, you know, you don't get the pass that, well, there's leaders in the church. I'm just not really one of them. But yet we say to lead others to Christ. That's not the responsibility of just leaders of the church. That's the responsibility of each and every one of us. All of us have influence. That we're influencing those around us. We're influencing our children. We're influencing our coworkers, our friends, everyone they come in contact with. There are many that may not consider themselves a leader, but they are influencing those around them. And there are many that may not realize the leaders that are around them, but they are being influenced in various ways. In fact, there are things and places and roles that influence us that we need to think about. The things we see on our phones, on the TV that influence. The speeches, the talks that we listen to, the books that I read influenced me. We're being constantly influenced. So where is that coming from? Am I confident that what is influencing me is from the Lord? Am I confident that the things that I'm giving to others are things that I've received first? Or is it just me wanting my way? Leadership is simple in theory, but difficult in execution. And we are constantly being bombarded by the influences around us. Are we blocking off the influences that we don't believe? Just as the story of the snake that we told this morning. Of the Boy Scout that comes across the snake, and the snake says, "Help me." He says, "No, you're a snake. You're going to bite me." The snake says, "No, I promise. Just help me. Take me to the other side. And I won't bite you." So the boy picks up the snake. Of course, immediately the snake bites him. He says, "Why did you bite me?" Because the snake slithers away. He goes, "You knew exactly who I was. You knew exactly what I would do. Don't blame me for your bad choices." We are constantly being influenced. We are constantly being told by the snake, "Help me. Just come pick me up. You'll be okay. You'll be all right." Are we blocking off the snake and saying, "You won't influence me. This will not influence me. I know from history this influence that is frequently in my life is not good for me. So I will do my best to not even be around it. And if I have to be near it, I will ignore it. I will keep it away because I know." Football's not even on yet. The leaders that are around us have influenced us in such great ways. I know one of my favorite leaders that I've ever been around at one point told me that he was concerned for the coming generations because he doesn't see the generation that's coming growing up being leaders. They want to grow up to be managers instead. He said the difference is managers do well with stuff and processes and things. They don't really know anything about people. Leaders lead people. He said, and all I see lately is people that I expect to want to be in positions of leadership just want to be in positions of management. They don't want to build the relationships. They don't want the responsibility. They just want the title. They just want to do the stuff. Because they don't want to be led to be able to lead. You don't have to be led to manage things. I can know how many oil filters are on the shelf just fine. I can keep track of that. I can know how many tires are in the back that we need to keep track of. That's management. But to know that one of my guys is having a rough time because he didn't stay in last night because his water pipe broke. He didn't have to stay, in the hotel that night. And to know, man, the fact that he is here, praise him. Today's probably not the day to ask him to do any more than is necessary. That's it. And this morning, I saw another fantastic example of leadership. Miss Artie. I've known you almost as long as I've been married. Take that for what it's worth. I remember when you first came here, it was like there were so many voices trying to speak to you, but you couldn't quite see them all. In the past couple years, I was blessed to be able to see you not just find a voice, but that voice was for drowning out all the other voices. You came up here today and you led a worship. And you look so good. I'm so proud of you. Sometimes that's what it is. Sometimes it is all those influences, it is all those voices that are constantly all around us saying, "You should look like this, you should do this, you should act like this, you should say these things, you should be these things." And say, "No, I don't need to listen to all of those voices. There is one voice that I listen to." Joshua received one voice. He was able to drown out all of the others. And true leadership is receiving that voice and knowing that other people need to hear it too. That other people are being bombarded by voices on a daily basis. And they too are sometimes just floating in. Leadership is not standing up with a badge that says, "I'm the boss," and telling people what to do. Leadership is being led and knowing that no matter what I do, I'm going to influence the people around me because that's just how influence works. So the question is, what does influence look like? How are we influencing those around us?
Are we influencing them like the snake? No one likes them. Maybe. Are we influencing them like Joshua, who's received the influence to give? It's, you can't remain indifferent to it. There was a line this morning that I heard that all those who hear the word of the Lord, you cannot remain indifferent to it. You can disagree with it, or you can agree with it, but you can't ignore it. Leadership is the same. You are going to be leading things. You are going to be influencing things. You can't just not. That's not a possibility. So what does that look like? If I was to go sit in a room by myself for a week and not meet another person, the lack of me being places would influence them. So what does our influence look like? Is our influence drawing others to Christ? Is our influence bringing them to that voice that can drown all the voices? Or is our influence being indifferent to them? Well, I know things I'd love to tell you about a voice, but maybe another day. I have a gift that is the greatest gift I could possibly receive. Maybe I'll tell you that sometime. I have this light in my heart that allows me to walk through the darkness and be lit. And I know you're wandering through the same darkness without a light. Maybe I'll tell you tomorrow. We are always influencing those around us. So what does that look like? Who will you influence today just by going through your day? Who will you influence tomorrow just by going through your day? And what will that influence look like? Heavenly Father, we thank you that you have given us examples, that you have not asked us to figure this out and not know what good looks like. That you have given us people like Joshua and Moses and David and Jesus and Paul to show us what true leaders look like. That you have given us clear examples. In fact, I remember reading through the Bible and seeing be led, I will lead you hundreds of times more than you asking others to go lead people. Father, your word makes it clear that you are always leading us. And Father, we pray that as we go through this week, that influence pours into us and you give us the courage, be strong and courageous to lead others to you, to lead others to the light in the darkness, to lead others to the voice in the crowd, to lead others to you. Father, we thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.